This conference is a pretty unique opportunity to bring energy leaders from the public and private sector around the world together, as you've seen this afternoon. And then it's also a chance to spotlight some of the most innovative and cutting-edge research that we have going on at Columbia on key energy issues. And so this year, we wanted to pick one issue, as we do each year, to sort of spotlight some of the research being done that's very relevant to everything you just heard about over the last few panels. And hear a little bit about the research being done by Professors Alissa Park and Peter Kelemen, both members of the Center's Faculty Steering Committee on the issue of carbon capture, storage, and utilization, and then hear from two of the world's leading experts and researchers on this issue. And for that discussion, I'll ask David Sandalow to return to the stage. Thanks.
Thank you, Jason. So more than 40% of the electricity in the world today comes from coal. And I just looked up the numbers. There are estimated to be at least 300 gigawatts of coal-fired capacity under construction in the world today. And by some counts, as much as 1,000 gigawatts of coal-fired capacity under development. And for the past two panels in this conference, we've heard extremely rosy scenario assessments of the opportunities for two types of fossil fuel, for natural gas and for oil and their future. So at the same time, the world community has committed to very deep decarbonization. The world community has said that it wants to limit the increase in global temperatures to no more than 2 degrees centigrade, which is 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, and achieve net zero emissions by the second half of this century. So any strategy for achieving those aggressive decarbonization goals, in the views of many experts, requires carbon capture, utilization, and storage, and that's what we're going to talk about in this panel. We have an incredible panel to do that with. So let me just quickly add to Jason's introductions. Right to my right, we have Julio Friedmann, who's the Senior Advisor for Energy Innovation at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory. He has just returned from a tour serving in a senior position at the U.S. Department of Energy in Washington as well. We have Dr. Alissa Park, who's the director of the Lenfest Center for Sustainable Energy here at Columbia. We have Dr. Peter Kelemen, who's the chair of the Earth and Environmental Sciences Department at Columbia. And Ahmad Khowaiter, who is the chief technology officer at Saudi Aramco. It's a tremendous panel. Let me just start with you, Julio. I think many people in the audience, some people in the audience know about carbon capture, utilization, storage. Some people don't. Could you give us the three-minute primer? What is CCUS?
My pleasure, and thank you for having me. I'm just really delighted to be here. The great bank robber, Willie Sutton, robbed banks because that's where the money is. If you care about carbon emissions, you should care about CCS because that's where the carbon is. Frankly, what it is, first and foremost, is an emission abatement technology. It is not a coal technology. It is not a gas technology. It is not a heavy industrial technology. It is a technology to reduce emissions from existing point sources or new fossil point sources. That's it. And it comes in two pieces. It comes in the carbon capture part and the carbon storage part. The carbon capture part's pretty straightforward. You concentrate the CO2 from some dilute stream. And in doing so, you get it to something like 95% purity. That allows you to then inject it underground in a way in which the Earth is configured to store it. That's the second part, carbon storage. It turns out that the Earth is pretty well configured to store CO2. There are many places around the world. Just in North America, we estimate something on the order of 3,000 billion tons of storage capacity in conventional reservoirs. And the punchline here is that we know how to do both of these things. We know how to do capture, and we know how to do storage. And we've known those for a very long time. I'm often asked, like, isn't it pixie dust or some future untested technology? That's total bollocks. We've been capturing CO2 at scale since 1938. We've been injecting CO2 in large volumes underground since 1972. And we've been combining these two things at the scale of a million tons a year for over 20 years, and now have 16 operating facilities around the world where we understand the cost and performance quite well. I should mention that today the Secretary of Energy, Rick Perry, is in fact doing a ribbon cutting on the 16th of these projects at the Petronova plant in Texas, which has been operating since June.
Well, thank you, Julio. So, Alissa, Julio says that we understand something about the costs related to carbon capture and storage. How expensive is it to do this, and do you see the cost coming down?
Julio, you made it sound like we already know how to do it. Now I don't have anything to say. So the main issues is that the scale, because capturing CO2 from coal-fired power plant is similar to capturing sulfur dioxide. We talked about acid rain, and we fixed it by putting scrubbers on power plants. The issue is the scale. The amount of sulfur versus carbon is a huge difference. So installing these large units costs a lot of capital investment as well as operating costs. Right now, costs for CO2 we all kind of quote, including capture and as well as compression to send it into the pipelines, is about $60 to $100 per ton. And that's assuming we are using amine-based solvent, which is we know most of. And as he mentioned, Petronova, and as well as another large-scale demonstration in Canada, Boundary Dam projects, they're using amine-based solvent. And it works very well. It captures CO2 very well. But the problem is that it does take a lot of energy. It means that our power plant efficiency will go down because the energy required for CCS will be used from the power plant itself. So questions are quite different in different countries because we have very old power plants in the United States. So our efficiency, which we can work with, is not a lot. Compared to in the newer power plants in developing countries, might have more wiggle room. So that cost is something we need to worry about. And we're also looking at how to reduce the parasitic energy consumption in the amine capture systems by using maybe waste heats and things like that. But we also have many studies going to novel materials, which doesn't have water or solid systems or membranes. So we are working in that area. But I think one of the things I'd like to point out is that until now, most of R&D in this area was just focused on coal-fired power plant. But you heard from the previous panel that we did a lot of fuel switching in the United States. So capturing CO2 from natural gas-fired power plant or decarbonizing our other sectors like chemical sectors or cement plants and steel plants will be very different. So I think for our future, we really need to looking at, instead of just looking at one type of CO2 source, looking at wide range of concentrations ranging from air all the way to cement plant and how to capture this effectively, and hopefully costs will go down quickly.
I'm just, both Julio and Ahmad, I'm interested to get your reaction to what Alissa just said. Her range was $60 to $100 a ton today to capture carbon dioxide. Do you guys agree with that?
Go ahead,
Julio.
All right. Today, actually, I think that's right if you're going to retrofit an existing plant. Mm-hmm. I should mention that the wind production tax credit is also about $60 a ton. The Energiewende is $300 a ton. If you're looking at this in a competitive context, that's the estimate, by the way, from JP Morgan in 2015. So if you're looking at this in a comparative basis, the cost today in terms of power supply are competitive and, in fact, are cheaper than offshore wind, new build nuclear, and rooftop solar on a levelized cost of electricity basis, unsubsidized.
Ahmad, you're shaking your head up and down. You agree with that?
Yeah, I think definitely the existing technology, the commercial technologies are in that range of above $60 a ton, up to $100 a ton and higher. But we see a lot of interesting technologies in the lab today and being commercialized and on their way to be commercialized. So we're seeing numbers below $40 a ton and some possible even lower than that. So I think the cost of capture is becoming less and less of a challenge. You know, there's probably three challenges facing the carbon capture and utilization. It's the cost of capture, it's the market mechanism, and it's the geological storage. I think that the cost of capture, we've almost licked that. I think we're getting close to solving it. It depends on what you're gonna, how much the cost. But I think the geological storage and the issues with that, that's a challenge still. And the market mechanism, we're working on that, and it's coming.
Boy, that is an incredibly perfect segue to the one person on this panel who's yet to speak, Peter Kelemen, who's done groundbreaking work. For the pun, he's done incredible work on capturing carbon dioxide and sequestering it underground. Peter, what's your assessment of our ability to keep the carbon dioxide underground once we've captured it?
Yeah, let's talk about storage. So. Julio and I had a little chat beforehand, so I knew we were going to disagree a little bit. Storing CO2 is not that easy, and in fact, I'd like to sort of push back a little bit about that because The idea that it's easy seems to be causing a lot of industry players to sit on the sidelines and wait until it pays before they really jump in. And I think there's still an awful lot of research and development to be done. So first of all, the idea that we're going to put all our CO2 into depleted oil reservoirs is not correct, and especially when emissions are growing at 2 to 3% per year with a 25 to 35 year doubling time. That's not very long, and so inevitably there'll be twice as much CO2 as there ever was oil. Deep saline aquifers have been the kind of go-to reservoir for storage of CO2 for the past 50 years or so, and estimates are still pretty uncertain about their total volume, but it looks like we could store centuries of human output in deep saline aquifers, and we could do so for millennia if our goal was 10% of human emissions. There's only 2 to 4 tests. So enhanced oil recovery, oil companies are injecting tens of millions of tons in the ground every year, but most of it is recovered with oil. In terms of real storage projects, there have only been 2 to 4 tests that have injected at 1 million tons per year for any length of time that have ever succeeded. And there's been at least one case where they actually had to stop because the cap rock fractured. So just to put that in context, 1 million tons a year is 25 millionths of human output annually, all right? And in order to take up 10% of human emissions, that requires 4,000 megaton per year plants up and running simultaneously. So it's a huge technological challenge. It's not something we're going to do overnight. And there's lots of significant issues with how that comes to scale.
Peter, what do we know about leakage, too?
Well, we don't know much about leakage, but I guess, I mean, taking a purely scientific viewpoint, leakage is not a big deal. If we inject 10 or 100 times faster than it leaks, from a purely scientific point of view, this is not a big issue. And I think the perception of leakage risk drives the perception of monitoring cost. And so the more you worry about leakage at the 0.1% level or something like that, the more it's going to cost to do. So I would encourage a kind of a sanguine view of leakage.
Okay, you said that Julio disagreed with you, so I want to give Julio a chance to say why.
No, he only disagrees with the easy or hard part.
And then I'm curious, Ahmed, if you agree with this assessment as well.
I don't actually disagree with easy or hard, but I would not say that it's easy. I'd say it's straightforward. Yeah. We know how to assess the reservoirs. We know how to drill the wells. We know how to monitor them. The question is, do we do that well? Often, actually, that's the rate-limiting step on a project. It actually takes longer to do that straightforward work than it takes to build the capture plant and start running it. It's something which requires diligence and focus, but there's no mystery about what one does associated with that. I would also say that something that is often overlooked in this is, yeah, we actually do have a massive scale-up issue, but if we're talking about 10 billion tons of storage a year, that's about equal to the transportation volume. We've built those infrastructures, we've operated them. I would also add that over the past decade, we have spent $2.2 trillion invested in clean tech. 1% of that has been on CCS. So one can make a case that some rather straightforward investment around CCS might accelerate the pace of adoption.
So let me jump in a little bit more. So there's another storage option. It's far more in the R part of R&D, and that is solid storage. So that, again, this idea has been around for 20 years, that we can induce various silicate rocks to combine with CO2 to form carbonate minerals. And once you've done that, you've basically got permanent storage on a human time scale, permanent storage of CO2 that you don't really need to monitor and will never leak. There is a recent experiment that was pretty successful in Iceland called CarbFix. If you're not familiar with it, you can Google that. But they only injected about 200 tons of CO2. So although we clearly lost that in mineralization, it's not a very large amount. So stay tuned for CarbFix Phase 2, where they're going to up their injection amount by a factor of about 500, and let's see how well they do. In terms of uptake capacity, it's absolutely giant, about 40 trillion tons in the United States. And there are many other countries where there are subaerial exposures of the right kind of rocks within a few kilometers of the surface that could capture and store similar amounts. And in terms of science fiction, if we were to go offshore, it's an absolutely giant reservoir capable of taking up about 25,000 years of output at current rates.
Ahmad, your company, Saudi Aramco, is doing this today. Could you tell us what Saudi Aramco is doing in this area?
Sure. We have a whole range of research projects and research areas. Ranges all the way from carbon capture, mobile carbon capture on board automobiles, all the way to carbon utilization, conversion into useful chemicals and materials. And we do a lot of carbon capture materials as well. But one of the major projects we did recently was a couple of years ago, in 2015, we built one of the largest carbon capture and EOR, enhanced oil recovery projects in the world. It's about 800,000 tons of CO2 per year being injected on the flank of one of our major reservoirs, our biggest reservoir in the world, actually. And it's not for economic reasons, because we really don't need, you know, our reservoirs are very young, so we don't really need tertiary recovery. We're still in the primary and secondary recovery phases. But it was really a scientific experiment. And what's unique about this is that we're actually, we invested a lot in the measurement. So we put in about 1,000 geophones at about 70 feet down under the ground, so that we could continuously in real time monitor, actually like a UT, kind of like a ultrasound. We see kind of what the flow of the front of the CO2 is and how it expands within the reservoir. So really, to answer some of the questions about how long does this take, and how long can we keep it in the ground permanently? So how much of this is gonna stay underground? All those questions can be answered only when you take these kinds of measurements. So it's a very in-depth scientific experiment. It's on a large scale. We, you know, we capture 800,000 tons a year, and we transport it about 80 kilometers to where the field is, and we inject it in about four wells, injection wells, alternating with water, because that's the best way to do enhanced oil recovery, and we then produce it. So we have a pretty large area, which is basically a scientific experiment, and our scientists are watching this as we go and trying to really build the models that will predict the future of CO2 injection.
You mentioned right at the beginning of your comments mobile onboard capture from vehicles. Could you just say a word about that?
Yeah, so this is something, as usual, scientists like to do things that are crazy, and then they find out that it can be done. It's something most people didn't think would be done. And what we did in our first experiment was basically built a large truck and put a bunch of carbon capture material, basically a system that you wouldn't want to drive around in, basically, but it was a pilot and a prototype, and it was just a concept. And it turned out we could capture about 11% of the CO2 from the truck. So we took that to the next step and took made it 8 times smaller, fit it in the back of a Camry, and now we're capturing 25% of the CO2 exhaust from the vehicle. And it's stored in a tank where you basically depressurize it at the petrol station, and then you have to do something with the CO2, but you know, you can sell it for now. It's a very interesting technology. We're taking it to the next step. We're going to go to 40%. Our next target is 40% on a large heavy-duty truck. And the thinking is, where's the application? Application might be in fleets, in heavy-duty fleets, where there's not too many options. You can't really electrify a Class 8 truck. So the idea of capturing the CO2 might be feasible. Yeah.
So I was one of the academics who said that never going to happen. So I've been talking about the last 10 years. So when I actually visited them last year, I saw that it does exist. And I guess decarbonization of transportation sector, we didn't think it would happen that way. We thought it would be electric vehicle more than going towards to capturing CO2 on board. I will say it will be very difficult to do it on the airplane. Can I stay with that for now?
I wouldn't rule it out. I would be careful, because it's actually, from a mass point of view, it's not a big deal. The CO2 you capture, on average, is about 1.5 tons. The weight of the plane doesn't change much, because the fuel, you know, the CO2 is 3 times as the weight of the fuel, basically. Yeah. So on average, about 1.5 times additional weight of a fuel. So it really can be done if you have a propel plane. The jet planes are a little more difficult, but propeller planes, we can do it.
If you have questions for our panelists, put them on cards. I see a question up here for those who are collecting the questions. Alissa, I want to turn to you to ask about another strategy for carbon once it's been captured. We've talked about how one can bury it underground. There's work going into utilizing the carbon dioxide in products. Could you talk about the U in carbon in CCUS and what you think its prospects are?
So as Julio mentioned, we've known how to inject CO2 underground for many years because we've been doing enhanced oil recovery. So we have a lot of know-how in that area, and that's basically using CO2 as a working fluid. Without changing chemistry of CO2, you can actually use to do something else. And we just didn't call it CO2 storage, but now we are trying to do that. And other movement is using CO2 as a working fluid, is even fracking shale using CO2. That's a really big area of research in China, because they don't have a lot of water near shale gas. But more importantly, I think this is a very interesting time for CCS, CCUS field, because until now, we didn't think we can do much with CO2, which we captured, because it's very inactive. It's really hard to activate CO2 again. But because the renewable energy price went down a lot faster than we thought, and its availability is right there, so that we can actually have a synergistic effect between renewable energy and carbon management. Because renewable energy is a current challenge penetrating into energy mix is that they need energy storage. Because their intermittency allows them, they cannot be base load unless they have good energy storage. Carbon-wise, we know that hydrocarbon has the highest energy density. So if you can convert renewable energy, heat or electron into hydrocarbon, or even split the water making hydrogen, we can actually store or transfer to somewhere. So a lot of research is going on. Can we store and buffer this renewable energy entire grid, either microgrid or large grid, using this CO2 conversion to chemicals and fuels? And I think by learning this in the future, we can really decarbonize our chemical sector, because at the end of the day, best carbon management is not to take carbon out of the ground, but we still need to live with the carbon. So if we can utilize the carbon either derived from biomass or capturing CO2 directly from air using abundant energy, which is carbon-free, that will be our future, in my opinion.
But I want to ask one more technical question before going to policy and politics. And Peter, there's been work here at Columbia and other places on direct air capture, pulling carbon directly out of the air. Could you tell us about that and your assessment of it?
Sure. So just for starters, you might think that that's very difficult. Air at 400 ppm by volume is 200 times more dilute than flue gas at about 10 weight percent CO2. So you can imagine that technologically, taking that 200 times more dilute CO2 out of air could be quite difficult. So it really comes down to what you want to pay. A lot of people, there are several methods out there that will take CO2 from air for a few hundred dollars a ton. There's no point in being more precise about this because they're very much in the research stage, but a few hundred dollars per ton. And so a lot of people would say, well, if you can do carbon capture and storage from smokestacks, make sure you've dealt with all the smokestacks before you bother with air capture. But on the other hand, again, with emissions growing and atmospheric CO2 continuing to rise, and again, with doubling time of 25 years or something like that, we're almost sure to exceed 500, 600, 700 ppm in the atmosphere before significant changes take place. If you don't think that's a sustainable limit, then you're talking about removing CO2 from air sooner or later, and then you can ask the question, why not get started now, at least develop the tools to do that? So that's kind of where we are. As I said, there are several engineered processes. And then the little window that I'm particularly interested in is combined capture and storage, again, using mineral carbonation. So these are site-specific methods, but where you have the right kind of rocks, you can basically take CO2 directly out of surface waters, out of seawater, and then return that CO2 depleted water to the sea surface where it takes CO2 out of air. So what are the advantages there? First of all, you're using spontaneous chemical reactions that don't cost anything. It's chemical potential energy that's just there. You're using the earth as a pressure vessel in a furnace because it gets warmer and higher pressure as you go down. And finally, you avoid all the costs of CO2 capture and transport in this particular mechanism. So at least from a thermodynamic point of view, it looks like it could be relatively inexpensive compared to some engineered methods. But this is really boutique stuff, okay? This is basic research, and not something that's going to be implemented on an industrial scale in the next decade or two. And finally, I mean, I just think we have to ask ourselves what this is worth, what it's worth to us to have an atmosphere with 500 or 600 ppm rather than more. And that really comes down to a philosophical question. Do I have time for, I don't know how I'm doing in my 3 minutes.
You're over.
All right, so here's my favorite anecdote about this. London became the world's largest city in about 1820, and there was no central sewers. Okay, so if you were poor, you threw your waste out into the street, and if you were wealthy, you had a pipe that took it to a cesspool. So already in the beginning of the 19th century, they had linked cholera outbreaks to the locations of these cesspools. It was early epidemiology, but nobody did anything about it. And then in 1858, there was a summer when it didn't rain in London, and it was called the Great Stink. The royal court left London, Parliament debated leaving London, and instead they passed legislation and they dug up all the largest streets in the world's largest city and installed central sewers over the next 10 years. It cost about 2% of GDP. It's cost about 1% of GDP to maintain the sewers in London. No one is questioning whether that was worth it. Okay. One other thing to mention, there were certainly local impacts. If you were at the outfall of those sewer lines, you suffered. But most people benefited. So I think the parallels are very good. When people think putting CO2 in the air is like throwing poop in the street, then at 2% of global GDP, we can do a lot for you. The people here on this podium can do a huge amount of carbon dioxide management at 2% of global GDP. So it's really a question of when people will have that perception, okay? More than it is, I mean, technological development is important, and we're all working very hard to bring those costs down. But ultimately, you know, until people have the idea that it's like throwing poop in the street, we're not gonna spend what it costs. We can get ready, we can put tools in people's hands, but ultimately it comes down to perception.
That is a great transition to the politics. Julio, you're an eminent scientist, but you also just did a tour in Washington, D.C., and emerged with your scientific reputation enhanced, not degraded. But what is the domestic politics here in the United States on this issue right now?
So it's funny. Partly the problem is that it's exactly where I started. This is perceived as a coal technology, and so the politics have been bound up in coal power politics, and that's unfortunate. In fact, 20% of global emissions are from heavy industry, from things like petrochemicals and steel production and cement. We don't actually have a renewable alternative for these things. And CCS is kind of the only game in town for that. 25% of global emissions are agriculture, and they're very hard to manage. Again, this is a place where CCS ends up being useful. This has been one anchor of the politics, and attacked from both the right and the left. One of the things that I think is interesting is we are in a very, very strange place today, where despite the fact that the left and the right have problems with this technology, there is potentially a room in the middle around things like tax reform, whether it's tax credits or some other kind of infrastructure build incentive or whatever to help get the cost down. There's a few bills out there now. One of them is to treat CCS as a master limiter partnership. Another one is to provide tax-exempt bonding in the form of private equity bonds. There's another one that creates something like a production tax credit here called 45Q tax credit reform. These are bills that are out there that have broad bipartisan support, in fact. You have Sheldon Whitehouse in the Senate and Mitch McConnell in the Senate pushing this. You've got members on House Ways and Means in both parties pushing these things. There's a non-zero chance this might come through. It's also interesting to see the administration pick up CCS as a crowbar in discussions with Europe. I kind of find this delicious. Europe emits smug. This is infuriating. They've talked a great game in Germany and they spent a bunch of money, but their emissions have gone up. And that's just inside the country, not including what they import by wire from Poland and other kinds of things. And they have not done CCS anywhere. So it's interesting to see the administration say, hey, we're maybe interested in staying in Paris if more countries did more around CCS. It's worth knowing that 10 countries have already put CCS in their INDCs. This is not window dressing for these countries. I would mention that those leading countries include not just Canada and Norway, which are longtime players, but the United Arab Emirates and the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia are big on CCS, and they're voting with their feet. They're putting in money, and they've put in million-ton-a-year projects, and they are doing the work.
We're running out of time. We have a question from the audience that says, what about the political concern that the possibility of low-cost, scalable CCS at some point in the future disincentivizes the uptake of renewables?
Yeah, this is the moral hazard argument. I also find this odd. It basically says, if you avoid emissions today and invest in avoiding emissions today, you might miss a better way to avoid emissions in the future. I mean, this kind of doesn't make sense to me. I care about tons. If you care about climate science, you should care about climate math. Straight up.
Any other comments on the panel? Peter, you wanted to get in?
Well, yeah, let me just jump in a little bit. So a lot of times the environmental movement is its own worst enemy. And we basically have a lot of people involved in thinking about these things who will not accept any negative consequences. So let's just talk about CCS in that context. Suppose we wanted to do 10% of today's emissions. That's 4 billion tons of fluid. 4 billion tons of fluid is roughly what the oil industry moves around on the surface of the planet every year. It's not going to be pretty. It's going to be a huge industrial process. I think many of us think it would be very, very highly beneficial, but there is no doubt that there would be negative impacts locally. And until people are willing to do real cost-benefit analyses on this kind of thing, and look at the cost of doing nothing versus the cost of doing something and make those comparisons, we're not going anywhere.
Super fast, 10 seconds. I'll also come back to where Diane Regas was earlier today. We're just not moving fast enough. We know that. Paris is on 2.7 degrees if you're optimistic, 3 to 3.5 if you're not. We just need to do more.
We're almost out of time. Maybe a final word here. Ahmed, we have a question about the need for private sector investment in this area and public sector investment. Your company's investing in this. How much can happen in the private sector?
I think a lot can happen in the private sector. I'm actually a believer in market forces and market, and rather than a cost, turning this into a value. So CO2 now is seen as a loss. We are investing in research that converts CO2 to value. You know, CO2 was the original feedstock. You know, plants, everything we have in the world came from CO2, because CO2 was the feedstock for all the materials we had. And that can happen again. I mean, the fact that we are using hydrocarbons is because they're at a high energy density. It's easy to come down. It's easy to come down to the materials we need, but you can also go up. So CO2 may be at the bottom of the energy curve, but if you have to do something which needs an oxygen in it, a hydrocarbon with oxygen, you can meet in the middle. So we're doing things like that. We're working on hydrocarbons combined with CO2 to give us really valuable chemicals, like our Converge technology. It's a technology we brought to the market, and it is now basically 50% CO2. It's a polyurethane that's 50% CO2 and 50% hydrocarbon. So we're taking CO2 and putting it in something and making it more valuable. And if you look at the economics of that, that's really interesting economics. The hydrocarbons are $500 to $1,000 a ton. That's oil. But the CO2 is negative. People don't want it. Now, if I can replace that $50,000 to $100,000 a ton with something that's not worth anything, that's fantastic economics. That's profit to me. So I think the profit incentive is what we got to work on. What we have to work on is how can we create more products? How can we close the carbon cycle like plants have been doing for millions of years and make money from it? Because you will. You will, because it's cheap. CO2 is the feedstock of the future, in my opinion. If we stop producing CO2, by the way, I'm going to wonder where we're going to get these chemicals, the hundreds of millions of tons of chemicals that we produce every day. So I'm a big believer that we can turn it around. We're doing a lot of research in converting CO2 to chemicals. Right now, polyols, polycarbonates in the future, many other chemicals, almost anything with a carbon and an oxygen in it, we can make money from with CO2. So I think the chemistry is the secret, it's the science, but we have to accelerate. We have to invest in our universities, and that's where I think the biggest value is. I think ARPA-E has done a wonderful job here in the U.S. Around the world, we're investing in universities. In Korea, we have a fantastic research team. In Saudi Arabia, in King Abdullah University of Science and Technology. Here in MIT, we do some work as well. There's some great research going on. We have to accelerate to get to the market, and we can actually have an impact.
We could have used twice the time with this incredible panel. Please join me in giving them a big hand.